Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for coming. At the end of the lecture, I would be happy if you would understand the underlying causes of hoarseness, that you learned what to look for and how to choose the most suited imaging modality, and that you became familiar to the differential diagnosis and limitations of diagnostic studies. Now, hoarseness. A voice that sounds breathy, strained, rough, raspy, or has a higher or lower pitch. Incidentally, these type of voices can be heard from all of us who yesterday night went to the ECR party. But we would have no imaging abnormalities. So this is a common symptom with many causes. The general practitioner approach is that to treat these patients conservatively or with antibiotics, and if the hoarseness persists for more than 3 weeks, to refer these patients in Holland to a head and neck specialist. So if you have something seriously, you always have 3 weeks doctor's delay. The differential diagnosis is broad. Hoarseness can be caused by neoplasms, inflammation, trauma, other causes, and vocal cord paralysis, VCP. Just some imaging examples. This is a CT scan at the level of the right true vocal cord. You see this benign vocal cord polyp. This is the endoscopic view. This is a benign lesion causing hoarseness. And this is laryngeal cancer. So normally in the coronal plane, we see the muscular density of the true vocal cord. And then just above it, more fatty density of the false vocal cord. Here you see an infiltrating lesion involving both the true cord and the false cord. So you can imagine that this cord is not moving normally. Infection can be a cause of hoarseness. Laryngitis, bacterial, viral, tuberculosis, allergic laryngitis, reflux laryngitis, which is typically intermittent. And more rare, Wegener's and Sicord. This is from our colleague from Kuwait City, Ahmed El-Bataghi, who wrote about this patient with a pulmonary reactivation of tuberculosis, but also with an acute tuberculous laryngitis. This is at the level of the false vocal cord. Normally, we would expect fatty density in the paralaryngeal space. Now, here we see these nodular enhancing lesions, probably submucosally concentrated, and in the true vocal cord area in the anterior commissure, another enhancing nodular lesion. This is somewhere specific, I don't think so. This could be cancer or amyloid, other diseases. Of course, you need a biopsy, but you have in this particular patient a clinical picture. Trauma can cause hoarseness. This is from our own clinic. This is a patient with a fracture of the thyroid. You see this high density area anterior in the left vocal cord, a hematoma. Of course, this cord cannot move normally. But there are also iatrogenic causes of trauma, especially post-intubation patients, where you can have granuloma formation. This is an endoscopic view of such a post-intubation granuloma. And if you have a direct trauma during long-time intubation, you can get arytenoid subluxation. So an abnormal position of the arytenoid, abnormal position of the vocal cord. And other types of surgery can cause damage to the recurrent laryngeal nerve, especially thyroid, cardiac, and lung type of surgeries. We have other reasons, other causes for hoarseness. For instance, Reinke's edema. This is a nice endoscopic view from the internet. You see a thickened right vocal cord, and this is due to fluid in the subepithelial space. So the surgeon sees a normal mucosal surface, no evidence of squamous cell cancer, but he sees a swelling. And this is related to smoking and or voice abuse. Endocrinological reasons, especially hypothyroidism, and patients who received radiation and or chemotherapy can get scarring of the true vocal cords, which influence, of course, movement. And from our medical days, we all remember that there are also psychological causes without any anatomical substrate for hoarseness. And then we have vocal cord paralysis, VCP. The offending lesion then is in the course of cranial nerve 10. vagus, the vagus nerve, and in Latin that is the wandering nerve. Here you see this nerve wandering from the skull base through all kinds of areas of the body, to the heart, stomach, esophagus, and the gut. And also we have these two interesting branches which go into the larynx, the recurrent laryngeal nerves. From an imaging standpoint, vocal cord paralysis is the most interesting. So for the rest of the lecture, I want to zoom in on VCP, and for any radiological topic, we have to review the anatomy and develop an imaging strategy. So about imaging strategy, if you have a so-called proximal vagal neuropathy, this means that the lesion is located at the area of the skull base or posterior fossa, MR is the way to go. If you have a distal vagal neuropathy, then the lesion is in the neck or upper mediastinum, and I think CT will be the best choice. Proximal vagal neuropathy, clinical clues is that you not only have a deficit in the vagus nerve, but that you have multiple cranial nerve deficits because these nerves go through the jugular foramen. And also the hypoglossal nerve is very near in that area at the skull base. Patients who have a bilateral VCP also usually have a central offending lesion. So, anatomy of the proximal vagus nerve. The nucleus of the nerve is located in the medulla. So it is in the medulla, and then the nerve comes out. You have a small intracisternal segment, which you can see here. And then it goes through the jugular foramen together with cranial nerve 9 and 11. So these three are very intimately related, and also the hypoglossal nerve is in that area. This is a patient with an acute onset of hoarseness. MR image in the neck shows you a dilatation of the piriform sinus on the right side and a medialization and some thickening of the aryepiglottic fold. And at the level of the true vocal cord, you see a paramedian position of the right cord. So the combination of these findings, and I will come back to that later, is very indicative of a vocal cord paralysis on the right side. Of course, you have images around the skull base, and we see a lesion here on the right side. And this is exactly in the expected position of the nucleus of the vagus nerve. This was an acute medullary infarct. Here another patient, a male patient, 42 years, who has since 6 months has voice and swallowing problems. Now, we have two images from the neck CT, which show a lot of abnormalities. These two images will tell you that three cranial nerves are out. Let's review the imaging findings. The right cord is a little bit hypodense and a little bit smaller than the left cord. So, in fact, this cord is atrophic, and the other cord is trying to compensate for the volume loss of the paralyzed cord by becoming a little bit bigger in a more median position. So, we have fatty atrophy of the right vocal cord, so 10 is out, and the left cord is trying to compensate for that. Also, we have an asymmetric presentation of the sternocleidomastoid muscle. So you have complete sternocleidomastoid atrophy on the right side, so 11 is out. Then we have here the tongue with complete fatty replacement of the tongue musculature on the right side, so the hypoglossal nerve is also out. So now you have a combination of multiple cranial nerve deficits on the right side. And just reading these two images, you are already pretty sure that there has to be a lesion at the skull base area on the right side. There was a lesion, very enhancing lesion with aggressive bone destructions around the jugular foramen, very characteristic aspect of a glomus tumor. Distal vagal neuropathy. The lesion should be somewhere in the neck or in the upper mediastinum, and CT is the way to go. Vagus nerve is unfortunately not visible on CT, so we should know the expected course of this nerve. Clinical clues, you have an isolated vagus nerve deficit. If this includes the recurrent laryngeal nerve, you will have a vocal cord paralysis on that side. Please note that up to 30% of these patients are asymptomatic. They are not hoarse, because of successful compensation of the other cord. So radiologists must not only know the expected course, but also the signs of VCP. So anatomy of the distal vagus nerve. Just below the skull base, we have the nodose ganglion, and from there, there are three important branches, pharyngeal plexus branch, sensation to the pharynx, superior laryngeal nerve, sensation to the supraglottic larynx, and for this talk, most importantly, cranial nerve 10. So we know that the cranial nerve is located in the carotid space. You know this space is a layer of fascia which encircles the carotid artery and the internal jugular vein. But also in that area on the posterior side, the vagus nerve is enclosed. It runs from the skull base into the mediastinum on the right and the left side. So the right recurrent laryngeal nerve, we can find it at the BCA bifurcation. Brachiocephalic artery is here, it bifurcates, and at that point, the recurrent laryngeal nerve on the right side branches off. And this distance is about 6 centimeters. The left recurrent laryngeal nerve goes much more inferiorly. It travels to the level of the aortic arch and then loops under the AP window, aortopulmonary window, and then travels back to the larynx to innervate the cord. And this distance is 12 centimeters. So this nerve is much more vulnerable for pathology, and you will see much more left-sided focal cord paralysis than on the right side. So when they have looped off from the vagus nerve, where do they run? Well, they run in the groove between the trachea and the esophagus, the TE groove on the right and left side. Now, the expected position of cranial nerve 10 and the recurrent laryngeal nerve. How do you read your normal neck images? Well, here we are at the level of the cricoid cartilage, and you know the vagus nerve is in the carotid sheath on the left side and on the right side, posteriorly. At this level, this is the highest point where we see the recurrent laryngeal nerve, because at this point it pierces the constrictor muscle to go into the larynx to innervate the cords. When we go down at the level of the BCA bifurcation, we will still see the vagus nerve in the carotid sheath on both sides. And here, because this nerve comes a little bit off laterally, the position is a little bit variable, but more or less in the tracheoesophageal groove. On the left side, the nerve is always exactly in the tracheoesophageal groove. And if you go down a little bit more at the level of the aortic arch, the expected position of the vagus nerve is anteriorly. The recurrent nerve has already looped under the arch and now is in the TE groove on the left side. So these are the positions where you are going to look for pathology. Now, the normal vocal cords on CT. If you have the right angulation, and we will talk about that later, then you can locate the cricoarytenoid joint. So here we have the arytenoids, and they have an articulation with the cricoid. If you see the cricoarytenoid joint, you will see the full stretch of the vocal cord with the muscular density, including the anterior and the posterior commissure. On the coronal image, always very characteristically, the muscular density of the vocal cords and cranial to it, more fatty density in the false vocal cord. And in between, we have this opening, this anatomical opening that separates all the glottic structures from the supraglottic structures. Head and neck surgeons in my center like to call this the sinus of Morgagni, and I like to call it the laryngeal ventricle. So you thought you had ventricles in your heart, but you have also 2 ventricles in your larynx. Now, imaging of the paralyzed cords, I would like to show you the top 3 signs with the highest specificity, and these show changes in other structures than the vocal cord. So these really are indirect signs. We have another 3 supporters signs who show vocal cord changes. So these are direct signs. The top 3 indirect signs is 1. At the level of the paralyzed cord, you see a small atrophic cord mostly on the posterior side, and you see this air configuration, which is the laryngeal ventricle, but it is enlarged. Secondly, you will see medial deviation of the airy epiglottic fold and some thickening of this fold. Normally, this is this angle, this is more medial, and you see dilatation of the piriform sinus. Now, to understand these three signs, the enlarged laryngeal ventricle is caused by atrophy of the vocalis muscle. The muscle becomes small, and therefore the laryngeal ventricle will passively dilate, so it will become bigger. This has been described in the literature as the sail sign, because this resembles a little bit the sail of a sailing boat. So this is the sail sign. So please do not interpret this as an abnormality. This is paralysis of the cord, and this is the result. Medial deviation and thickening of the AE fold and dilatation of the piriform sinus, they really go together. And to understand that, we have to concentrate on this muscle. Posterior cricoarytenoid muscle. This is seen from the posterior side. This is the posterior aspect of the cricoid, and here on the right and left side we have this posterior cricoarytenoid muscle, which goes around and is attached to the arytenoid, and this is in fact the only abductor of the cords. It's the only muscle that can abduct the cords. Now, when it gets paralyzed, you have inability to abduct. But please note that the airy epiglottic fold is also attached to the arytenoid. So if the arytenoid is medially deviated, the AE fold has no other choice than to do the same. So we also go to the medial side. The piriform sinus is just lateral to it. So once again, this will passively then dilate. So you will see medialization and some thickening because of redundancy of the airy epiglottic fold, and passive enlargement of the piriform sinus. The supportive signs, this is a reduced bulk of the true cord, so you see so-called pointing. Normally this is more round. You will see subglottic fullness. This is the undersurface of the true vocal cord, so we are already caudal to the cricoarytenoid joint, and you see some more tissue on the right side because of sagging of the paralyzed cord. And also, this time a left-sided paralysis, you see, will see the paramedian position because of the inability to abduct this cord. A patient example, this is a 70-year-old gentleman with recent hoarseness, and a CT of neck and upper mediastinum is requested. Supraglottic larynx, we see medialization and some thickening of the airy epiglottic fold and dilatation of the piriform sinus. This is our sail sign. Dilatation of the ipsilateral ventricle. So you already know that something is happening in those 12 centimeters from the aortic arch to the level of the cord. So you check that area, and the lowermost cuts show this necrotic lymphadenopathy in the aortopulmonary window. This was a lymph node metastasis from the primary lung cancer. There are also other causes of such a distal VCP. This is esophageal carcinoma, and of course this can infiltrate just this area of the tracheoesophageal groove. You can have any pathology in the AP window, like an aortic aneurysm, and this is thyroid cancer, of course, infiltrating the tracheoesophageal groove on the right side. You know where the expected position is, so you can specifically search for pathologies in that area. Limitation of imaging studies, of course, if we do these MR study, we have to use the proper coil and the state-of-the-art protocol, including gadolinium scans, and diffusion weighted imaging has become very important in the whole field of oncological imaging, so that should be included. And I want to focus a little bit on the CT. You want to use 3 millimeter diagnostic sections parallel to the true vocal cord plane, intravenous contrast, and of course, now we know that we have to scan up to the aortopulmonary window. And I will show you a pitfall on PET-CT. How to reconstruct in the true vocal cord plane? Simply ask the technologist to reconstruct the thin sections into 3 millimeter sections and then angulate parallel to the C4, C5 disc base, because it will almost always be in the plane, and this is the air in the laryngeal ventricle, so you are nicely in the plane of the vocal cords, and you can communicate with your ENT doctors about glottic and supraglottic pathology. If you don't, if you have a wrong angulation, you can see pictures like this. This is called the mushroom sign in literature. This is the atrophy of the cord. This patient had clinically a left-sided vocal cord paralysis. So this is the expected air in the laryngeal ventricle, but you, because of the wrong angulation, you can see some subglottic air on the right side. This is confusing. So please, if you see the mushroom sign, you know that you're not angulating correctly. Another CT pitfall, think about the carotid space as a cause for distal vagal neuropathy. These types of extracapsular aggressive lymph node metastases, of course, they can compromise the expected position of the vagus nerve, and then lower down cause problems with your recurrent laryngeal nerve. Incidentally, I think this might also be the cause of a Horner's syndrome. PET-CT pitfall, this patient had a right neck dissection earlier because of a small tongue carcinoma and now has hoarseness and a left vocal cord paralysis. And a PET-CT is requested. So these are some of the images that we were getting. Imaging findings, on the right neck dissection, no tumor activity, but they saw increased metabolism in the right two vocal cords. And the non-contrast attenuation CT shows you the characteristic paramedian position of the paralyzed left cord. Well, the explanation in this case, this is increased metabolism in a normal cord that once again tries to compensate for the paralysis on the left side, not to be mistaken of a sign of malignancy. So I think I'm back to my learning objections. There are many underlying causes for hoarseness. Think about these benign polyps on the true vocal cords, laryngeal cancer. We've seen a tuberculosis of the larynx, other types of inflammation, bacterial, viral. Trauma, either a direct high-speed accident or trauma induced by other doctors who introduced an endotracheal tube or did some types of surgery, thyroid surgery. Other causes, Reinke's edema, hypothyroidism, and we concentrated on vocal cord paralysis. I hope that you're now able to recognize these signs. Keep in mind that 30% of these patients are not hoarse, so the radiologist is the first person to report this. And then keep also in mind that you're just reporting at that point on a symptom, nice discovery, but you have to make a search for the offending lesions. This can be very serious pathology, like an aortic aneurysm or cancer. Please remember about the top three indirect signs. So the enlargement of the laryngeal ventricle, the thickening and medialization of the area epiglottic fold, and the passive enlargement of the piriform sinus. If you have these three signs, you are 90% sure that this patient has, in fact, a vocal cord paralysis. For a proximal vagal neuropathy, we like to do MR, distally CT. You don't want to see the mushroom sign. Think about the carotid space as a cause for a distal vagal neuropathy. And in PET-CT, beware of the increased metabolism in the normal cord due to compensation hypertrophy. Thank you very much.